Now let's look at the interface that's available for the stub that is on the client side and the server side through the subcontract mechanism. The first interface, of course, is for marshaling and unmarshaling. So the client side stub has to marshal the arguments from the client, and in order to do that, it has calls that it can make on the subcontract saying that marshal these arguments for me. The subcontract will do that for you. Depending on whether this invocation is going to go to a server that is on the network, or is it on the same machine, or is it on a different processor on the same machine, all of those details are buried in the subcontract. And therefore, when the client stub wants to marshal the arguments for a particular invocation, it just calls the subcontract and says, please marshal these arguments for me. And the subcontract knows the way in which this particular invocation is going to be handled, and so it can then do the appropriate thing for marshaling the arguments based on where the location of the server is. That's the beauty of the subcontract mechanism. And this is true on the server side as well as on the client side. And once the marshaling has been done, the client side can make the invocation. And when it makes the invocation, once again, the subcontract says, I know exactly where this particular invocation is going to go to, so it takes care of that. So the subcontract on the client side has this invocation mechanism, obviously, because the client is the guy that is going to make the invocation. On the server side, the subcontract gives a different set of mechanisms. It allows a server to revoke a service, or it allows a server to tell the subcontract that, yes, I'm open for business, by saying I'm ready to process invocation requests. So what you see is that the client side and the server side, the boundary is right here. The client stub and the server stub don't have to do anything differently whether the client and the server are in the same machine or in a different machine, replicas of the machine, cache copies of the machine. None of those things make a difference in terms of what the client, when I say client, I mean the client application plus the client stub, and similarly the server plus the server stub, they don't have to do anything different. All of the magic happens down below in the subcontract mechanism. So to recap the innovations in the Spring system, it uses object technology as a structuring mechanism in building a network operating system, and it ensures through the object technology that it is providing strong interfaces, it is open, it is flexible, and it is also extensible because it is not a monolithic kernel, it has a microkernel, and all the services are provided through these object mechanisms living on top of that kernel. And the other nice property is that the clients and the servers don't have to know whether they are co-located on the same node or they exist on different nodes of the local area network. And object invocations across the network are handled through the network proxies, and the subcontract mechanism allows the client and the servers to dynamically change the relationship in terms of who they are talking to. You can get new instances of servers instantiated and advertise that through the subcontract mechanism so that the clients can dynamically bind to new instances of servers that have been created without changing anything in the client-side application or the client-side stub. So those are all the powers that exist when you decide how to innovate under the covers, and which is exactly what Sun did with the Spring system.